Okay, good morning, pottery people. Welcome to clay class. Phil Lyons here. Today I'm going to make some slab boxes. I've done a project for years in my high school classroom where we made a slab box with a fitting lid. It's got a little flange that inserts. Cool project. You can make more of a geometric shape box or curves or whatever you want. But step one is making some slabs. Here at Dongzhu Pottery in Madison, Wisconsin, we don't have a slab roller yet. It's on order, but we can make slabs for the most part without even a rolling pin. So I just want to show you how to do that. So anyway, I've got some wonderful paoli stoneware, and this is going to be good for a few slabs. Let's see, I'm just going to start by cutting this in half a little bit. I don't need all this. So step one, let's just flatten the slab with the heel of my hand. I'm working on this awesome surface absorbent cement board, tile backer board. It works great for clay tables. So anyway, so I have this flattened out with the heel of my hand, and now I'm just going to grab the slab and I'm going to throw it down at an angle, and it's going to stretch the clay. So if I just do that a few times, it'll stretch my clay and I'll get a nice, relatively even slab that's ready to work with. And now I can just take my rolling pin and just kind of smooth things out a little bit. But this is a nice big slab that'll work for my slab box. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, this first slab is for my angular, sort of rectangular prism box. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to cut some pieces that I'm going to stash overnight under newspaper. So I have a wear board here and some newspaper. And I'll just take these slabs, perfect thickness, here, and I'm just going to put them under newspaper, and then tomorrow morning when I come into the studio, this will be leather hard. It just gets enough air that things stiffen up, and then I can, you know, work with it. It'll hold its shape for a wonderful angular slab box. In my classroom, we had a big wear board, a wear cart that kids would, you know, I'd clear it off for this project, and kids would, if they wanted to make an angular box, they'd make some slabs, put them under newspaper, write their name and their class hour, stash them on the wear cart until the next day, and then they'd have leather hard slabs ready to go. So this is a great strategy for doing that. So I'm gonna let these sit, and then I'll make this slab box tomorrow. Okay, so here's my slabs I made yesterday. I covered them with newspaper, and so now they're leather hard. They're at the perfect stage for me to cut and build a slab box. So let's get this out of here. I've got my awesome little canvas board that I just stretched some canvas over a piece of 3/4 inch plywood and stapled the back, and it's a wonderful surface to work on. So now I have to decide how big is my box going to be. Let's start with the base. I have this awesome little scraper that has a ruler on it. So I'm going to use this as my guide. Sometimes I would have kids make tagboard stencils, which works good too. 6x4. So there's my base. Now, you can do this. I've had kids make slab boxes that were, I mean, this is just, I'm just keeping it simple here. But I've had kids make tetrahedrons and just weird, like the letter of their name and all kinds of stuff. So I need another 6x4, and then I need a 4x4. Okay, and we're going to use this for our 4x4. Okay, I've got some nice leather hard slabs. They're pretty thin, so this is going to be a light box. It's a challenge making it this thin, but we are up for the challenge. Okay, so I'm going to start with my base. So, one of the tricks to doing this is to create nice beveled, mitered corners. So that your seams can be hidden more easily. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bevel this edge. So I'm going in about the thickness and I'm angling my knife and I'm cutting it at a 45. I'm going to do the same thing here. And that does a couple things. It hides the seam because the seam's going to be right on the corner. It won't be a quarter inch in. And it creates a larger surface area where things are connecting. I mean, I could connect my slabs like this. This is called a butt joint, right? But my seam is a quarter inch in from the actual corner of the box. And it's much harder to hide that seam than it is if I have a beveled edges, mitered corner like that. It's really easy to hide that seam. So what I'm doing now is I am going to just going to score and slip this edge. So I'm slip, score, slip. And then, I got to do my bottoms too, because this is connecting. So that's going to go there, and this that'll work. Okay. Now, if my measurements were relatively accurate, everything should line up.
Yeah.
Can see things are coming together. And then actually this seam is what I wanted to show you. This seam right here is going to be hidden beautifully. Now, I could have mitered where the sidewall hit the base too. And then I would have an easier time hiding this seam down here, but that's really hard to do. So at least some mitered connections, right? Okay, so I'm going to slide this off. I'm going to cut my other 45s here. I could end up taking my metal rib and trying to really flatten that out, but I can come back to that. And I could end up paddling as well. Now, as long as I'm here, I'm going to take my brush. Just work my inside corners a little bit so they're smooth and connected. So you can see that's a little better on the inside. So now I gotta put my top piece on. Usually I cut my top piece bigger and just let it hang over like I did with the oval box. And then I trim it later. But since this was all consistent measurements, we're just going for the exact size. Slip, score, slip. Let's see, which side do I want on the outside? I think the other side's a little smoother for what it's worth. I often use a toothbrush for spreading slip. In my classroom, we had slip containers that would, each slip container would have a few toothbrushes in it, and that almost, you know, if it's a stiff bristled brush, it can kind of score as you go. Okay, here's my box. Do solid connection here. Once this dries a little bit, I can come back and shave my edges, do a little paddling. But those corner seams, these corner seams are looking great, and that's all because of the mitered beveled 45 degree angle connections. And it, you know, it increases the surface area that it connects by an extra 50%. So that's good. So okay, so we are going to let this just chill for a minute and solidify, and then we're going to do some smoothing, and then we'll cut the lid off and do our flange like we did with the other one, okay?
There's a funny way of falling down this time of year. You need something to keep you from drowning in heaven's tears. I'd like to offer you some kind of haven from the storms outside.
So I could do the little flanges on these edges too, but I don't necessarily have to because it'll all lock together. It'll all lock together with just the side flanges, right? Okay, check out these two slab boxes. Almost finished. It's got the flange with the fitted lid. Locks right in there. And then the square box, also flange, fitted lid. It's got the angled walls, which are kind of fun. So that fits in nicely as well. I just make sure they dry with the lids on so everything's dries super even. Okay, slab box, fitted lid. Boom, two examples.